Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mokhtar Al-Shibani. I'm the president of GATE, the Global Alliance on Accessible Technology and Environment. I welcome you all in this evening, and I hope we will have a good time together. This is the first forum for GATE. We usually participate with the other partners, but GATE now is having its own its forum with other participants from the start of. The beginning, in 7 years ago, Betty Dune was the only representative of GATE in this UN building, and now we are, the last 7 years, we are working together with UNDISA. And the need for this forum raised from awareness on the needs for accessibility in the broader senses, the need for all countries to adopt standards for access, and especially as it related to healthcare and education. And this ties into the SDG, because without access, people with disabilities cannot participate in society in any way. Thanks to our sponsors, UNDISA, UNICEF, Gulf Organization Gulf Disability Association, and the Organization for Islamic Capitals and Cities, and of course, Zero Project. We have a program for this afternoon that will focus on access broadly, but also focus on education, and we will have the opportunity to listen to our members from Nepal, Mr. Deepak, who will tell us more about the current situation in Nepal and the conditions of Nepalese with disabilities. I hope you all a good time in this forum. Thank you. I will give the floor to Mr. Shuaib Shalkin to moderate it.
Thank you, Mukhtar. And welcome, everybody. I have the easy task here of just moderating the discussions. And we have a long list of speakers this afternoon, because we have our forum from 3 o'clock until 6 o'clock, and after 6 we will have a reception at the Vienna Cafe. So I would like just to say a few words about the speakers. And we have on the podium, first of all, Betty Dion. And Mukhtar mentioned earlier that Betty, you know, started, she was one of the founders of GATES, and one of the people that used to attend the first few conference of state parties that we had here in New York, when GATES was a very small organization, and it has grown tremendously. And Betty, being the past president, is a person with 35 years experience in universal and accessible design.
I think that's a typo.
Is that a typo? 35 years, that's revealing too much information. Okay. No, but Betty, yeah, and she's the past chair of the Canadian Standards Organization, and she's held so many different positions in terms of accessibility and universal design. So Betty is one of our speakers and one of the main participants, and the other person to my left is Rosangela, who's a good friend, Rosangela, from Brazil, and who works as the disability advisor at UNICEF now. So Rosangela is going to be speaking very briefly as well. Rosangela, is there anything else I can say about you without revealing too much? So Rosangela's got less than 35 years experience And but she's worked globally at the World Bank. That's where we met each other. And she's a very knowledgeable person when it comes to all the issues regarding disability, and especially children with disabilities. And then we have Tom Butcher on the podium. Tom, you know, everybody gave me notes on what to say, but all I can say is that Tom is a good friend as well, and a good friend of GAATES, because he represents the Zero Project. And Tom will be speaking about some of the issues around some of the activities of Zero Project and what will be happening in the coming year. Victor Pineda is going to join us as well. He's making his way onto the podium. And we are GAATES dealing with accessibility, and the podium is not accessible. So it's a bit of a problem. So I have to move a bit. Me.
Yes,
I can't get too close to the mic because the podium isn't accessible. Yeah, okay. So we're gonna, if there's a roving mic, it will be wonderful for Rosangela and Victor as well. But if not, we'll just manage.
That's
okay. So we still have to do a lot of work as GAATES on accessibility. But at the UN as well. But let's start our program for today. I'm going to hand over to Mukhtar again, and let me just briefly say a few words about Mukhtar Shibani. Mukhtar is the president of GAATES and has been a member of the Rehabilitation International RI before. He's an architect with a great passion for accessibility and for the rights of people with disabilities. So let me hand over back to Mukhtar.
Thank you, Shuaib. First of all, I would like to convey a message from His Royal Highness Prince Sultan bin Salman Al Saud, and he's supposed to be with us in this forum, but due to his some urgent commitment, he could not.
First of all, I would like to
what is happening?
I don't know.
A message from His Royal Highness Prince Sultan bin Salman Al Saud, and he's supposed to be with us in this forum, but
it's a mechanical, technical problem. I will start again. Prince Sultan bin Salman, supposed to be His Royal Highness, to be with us in this forum, but due to certain commitment that he had in the country, he could not make it. So I will give a brief information about him. Next. Prince Sultan bin Salman was born in Riyadh on the 27th of June 1956, and in June 17, 1985, he was chosen to be among the crew of the space shuttle Discovery as payload specialist on its mission STS-51G. He was the first Arab and the first Muslim and the first member of the royalty in the space. Shortly afterwards, he joined the Royal Saudi Air Force as a fighter pilot, from which he retired in 1996 with the rank of colonel. He is now the Minister of Tourism in Saudi Arabia. And next, his background started since 1980s. He has been interested in children with disabilities. After coming back from his space mission, he became the chair of the Children with Disabilities Association in Riyadh, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And 20 years later, he established the King Salman Center for Disability Research, then established a Council of Trustees to strengthen the center's mission. The center developed the first Saudi accessibility guidelines in the region, and the Royal Decree number 1914 was enacted in 2014 for promoting implementation of the accessibility in guidelines. Now, just I will give a brief about the King Salman Center for Disability Research. The center, which is motivated by religious and humanitarian concerns for persons with disabilities, is a major contribution to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and its society. Its activities focus on biological, social, and public awareness, as well as legal and regulatory research. Through collaboration and partnership, the center issued the flow of knowledge and technology and its utilization for the benefits of the people with disabilities in the region. We can see here a picture next for the first, when King Salman launched the application of accessibility program in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. And the three guidebooks that's been published, one is accessibility to built environment and accessibility to transportation, and the third is accessibility to tourism. These guidelines now are functioned, and the Prince Salman is, I think that's a brief about what the center is doing. Of course, if he was here with us, he will give us more information and more background of what's happening in the region. Thank you very much, Raib.
Thank you, Mukhtar. I also have you on the next item, Mukhtar. Dr. Alam.
Give a brief about him or say something about
him? Yeah, the next, we invited the GAATES Council of Trustees President, Dr. Abdulillah Alam from Saudi Arabia to this forum, but he couldn't make it, unfortunately. For health reasons, he couldn't travel. So he recorded a short clip, a video clip, that we'd like to share with you. So please, Andreas.
مع طموحاتها وأهداف سامية نحن جميعا نحمل رايتها من هنا يتضح حجم المسؤولية التي يحملها مجلس الأمناء في هذه المرحلة بالذات والذي هو منكم ومعكم ولكم أيها الإخوة كلنا نعلم أن من طبيعة البشر تؤمن بما ترى أكثر مما تسمع لذا كل انتشار لأعمال هذه المنظمة سيساهم في إيجاد التمويل اللازم لكل نشاطات وهذا مما يجعل مسؤولية مشتركة بيننا جميعا أيها الإخوة يسرني إبلاغكم جميعا أن مجلس الأمناء رئيسا وأعضاء قد تعاهدوا على توفير التمويل اللازم لبرامج هذه المنظمة أيها الإخوة نحن جميعا في مركب واحد نحمل مشعل نور لمجال لم يكتمل عقده رغم أهميته منذ التواصل الأول بين آدم وحواء عليهم السلام ختاما عدم حضوري والوقوف بينكم يؤلمني ولكن مشاعري وأفكاري حملتها إليكم كلماتي والسلام عليكم
Thank you, Andreas. So the next speaker we have is Mukhtar again, Mukhtar Shibani, doing an introduction to GAATES this time. Mukhtar?
Thanks again for giving me the chance to present some information about GAATES. As you all know, GAATES is an international organization based in Canada. Our main head office. And we are in more than 45 countries nowadays. So, next. GAATES is a leader international organization dedicated to the promotion of accessibility of electronic and communication technologies and accessibility to the built environment. And we are almost 6 years old after the convention being founded as the accessibility organization. Next. Our mission is to promote the understanding and implementation of accessibility of the sustainable built social and virtual environment, including architectural infrastructure, design, transportation systems, habitat, and electronic information and communication technologies so that everyone will participate and have a happy life. Next. Human diversity, coupled with the diversity and complexity of disability, requires a new way of thinking and understanding what an accessibility environment is. Meeting the needs of person with any disability, and that is the universal design. So including those with sensory and cognitive disabilities and the way they use, understand, and build environment. Next. So universal design, or design for all, as a concept that covers the complete complexity and diversity and of individuals and environments. UD means taking into account new buildings, adapting existing buildings, as where we are here now at United Nations, the urban infrastructure. It must permit to service and policy making as well. Okay. Ensuring a real understanding of way of what universal design, designed environment is, should be persuaded in public policies, urban environments, codes, standards, and norms. Training and capacity buildings is a crucial component for the success of this approach. Next. Children with disabilities in the world estimated suggested that there are at least 93 million children with disabilities in the world, but numbers could be much higher. They are often likely to be among the poorest members of the population. They are less likely to attend schools, access medical services, or have their voices heard in societies. Their disabilities also place them at a higher risk of physical abuse and often exclude them from receiving proper nutrition or humanitarian assistance in emergencies. So accessible is a child's basic right for inclusion into society. Accessibility should cover raising awareness in the community, should schools, environment, indoors and outdoors, education material, ICTs, staff training. Monitoring accessibility implementation, creating accessibility environments is a multi-steps process. Those steps include implementation, quality assurance, and monitoring. Accessibility indicators are necessary tools to monitor the progress and quality. Focus on accessibility. These forms will focus on both ends of the accessibility field of work, accessibility to education as the fundamental right for securing children's inclusion into society, accessibility and indicators covering policies and strategies as the necessary tools for a permanent monitor on implementations. Okay, so we can see the universal design as from the childhood to the elderly and all type of excessive things that is really needed. Next. So let us find out what is accessibility and what the solutions are in our next 2 hours. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mukhtar. Next speaker is Rose Angela.
Yeah, I think it's fine, right? Can you hear? I think it's fine. So good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much, the organizers, for putting this important session together. And it's a pleasure for UNICEF to be serving as one of the co-sponsors. For us, the whole discussion, both on accessibility and education, are critical for our work. We have been working on accessibility issues in different fronts, in UNICEF and also in education. Right now, we are extremely involved in the negotiations of the new sustainable development goals, and especially on the goal on education. In the goal of education, ensuring inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all, accessibility is a key component of it, and we have to ensure that it stays there, because in a recent version of the discussion on the indicators, this was one of the things that were cut off. So it's a big flagship for us here. In the whole negotiation also, we have the goal 11 on inclusiveness of cities and human settlements. Of course, accessibility, it's a key component of it. And so we are glad to be able to be here today and be able to discuss this. From UNICEF side, we have two initiatives on accessibility going up now that I want to briefly tell you about it. We are very excited. Our team is all here, and my colleague Gopal will have a chance to give you more details later on in the panel. But we have two new internal policies on accessibility, just walking the talk. One is about any construction that the UNICEF will undertake from now on. Every construction has to be accessible. And UNICEF is involved in construction of schools, of water and sanitation, child-friendly spaces, a lot of work on emergencies. So we consider that this not only it's very important to keep the coherence of the work we are doing in UNICEF, but also to influence other development partners in the same direction. The other one that we have is, again, walking the talk internally. It's another internal policy on premises, UNICEF buildings. So we have 5 years to have all the UNICEF buildings across the world accessible as well. And about this, I want to tell you something that I think is a very good news for us, but for our sector that could be considered in other circles as well of what we do. We had one UNICEF country office writing to us because they were buying a new building or constructing one, and they wanted to get information about accessibility. And they wrote to us at the same time they wrote to the senior advisor on greening for UNICEF. As you may know, the Secretary General of the UN now is pushing the whole system to become green, take care of all the environmental issues within the system itself and not only in programs outside. So the person from our country office wrote to us together with the person working on greening, and then at this moment we realized that it would be a very important thing to bring the two initiatives together, because greening without accessibility would not function, and accessibility would be a big waste of opportunity not to combine it with greening at the same time. So as a result of this conversation, we had another decision memo signed by our executive director creating the following: for every air trip that a staff in UNICEF takes now, 2% over the cost will go for a fund on greening and 1% on a fund on accessibility. So I think that this is an interesting mechanism that they found to finance or to fund initiatives internally on accessibility and greening. But more than this, I think it's a very good point that maybe it's a starting point. It should not be. We should be talking about this a long time ago, but now that greening has a strong focus and accessibility wants also to have the strong focus, it's also one opportunity to combine both. So with this, I just want again to thank you very much to allowing UNICEF to participate in the event, and Gopal will have a chance to give you more details about our work with GAATES and other activities related to education. Just one short word that I wanted to say is that in the different activities we are doing, and data collection is a very important one, and UNICEF is developing a new data collection module based on a household survey, and it's measuring school environment for children with disabilities. For this one, we have some components with GAATES as well. Not only we are interviewing the family, the mother, about issues related to the environment of the child in the house and how the mother sees this child going to school or not, what would be the reasons in the environment that the child is not going to school, but we are also developing tools to measure accessibility in schools, also measure social norms with the children in school, parents and teachers, and also how to start assessing the community for accessibility. So we are trying to approach both accessibility and education from different angles, and it's great to have partners like GAATES and others, and we hope to be working closely with as many of you as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rosangela. Let me just quickly say a few words about UNICEF and Rosangela. I used to be the Special Rapporteur on Disability, as I said earlier, the dubious distinction of the last Special Rapporteur in New York. And almost every year, when I delivered my reports, I would single out UNICEF for the work they are doing in a very positive way. You know? And it got me into some trouble because other agencies felt that they were also doing some work around disability, but it was never good enough. Now, one of the reasons why I did that was because, not saying, Rosangela, you don't do great work, you do amazing work, but because UNICEF took the step to appoint a focal point on disability, which the other agencies of the UN just refuse to do. And unless you do that, you're not going to make progress as an agency of the United Nations. You know, and we can have an accessibility center until we're blue. We can have all these centers at ESCAP, they have a center now, and they have this accessibility center here, and it's wonderful, and we've made progress. I'm just checking who else from the UN is here in the room, but anyway. I'm no longer the special rapporteur, so no one is going to have a discussion with me afterwards about the things I say. but I'm known for saying things, and I'm just saying things now, that as the special rapporteur, I used to travel to different countries, and I would find that in many countries, or most of them, the UN buildings were not accessible. No, this is serious. Seriously, this is, you just said now, it's going to take you 5 years to make UNICEF accessible, all your country offices. Right? That's brilliant. But nobody else is going to do that. You know? It's going to take them a long time. No, I'm not being negative, I'm just being realistic, because I, as a person who was a special rapporteur on disability, with a disability in this chair, could not get into an office of the UN that I was supposed to meet people in. And it became so ridiculous that even if you could get into the office, you couldn't use the bathroom, so you had to leave the office, go back to your hotel, use a bathroom, and go back to your meeting in the UN building. Now, it emphasizes two things. That one, the reason why, for me, why it takes so long for accessibility to be taken seriously, it's not because GAATES is not doing enough work. They're doing wonderful work, and UNICEF is doing wonderful work. But it's the invisibility of disability. Right? We are just not important enough yet, I suppose. But it depends on our voice, and that's why we're here today. But I just wanted to say that the reason why UNICEF is so successful is because Rosangela and Gopal, and Gopal and the whole team at the focal point have grown from strength to strength, and you have a committed executive director. You have an executive director who is committed to the issue of disability. So unless that happens, you're not going to make much progress, but we'll try. Okay, our next speaker is Betty Dion and Victor Pineda.
Staying or leaving?
Betty's going to start.
Betty's going to start.
Okay. Thank you very much, Shweb and Mukhtar and others. It's such a pleasure to be here and to see all of you today. Some old friends and some new. We're really excited and appreciate your participation. What I'm going to be presenting on right now is a project that we did with the government, with the Delta Center in Norway. And they envisioned a project looking at key indicators of accessibility in the UNCRPD. So the idea was to develop next please. Are you doing it? Yeah. Okay. So I just wanted to tell you a little bit. We've heard all of the information from Mukhtar and stuff and Shweb on what GAATES has done, but I thought there's nothing really better than to just highlight some of the work that we've done. So we're currently developing a handbook on implementing accessibility provisions of the UNCRPD. We did a huge document for UNDESA on the monograph on the UNCRPD, which led to an expert panel meeting with the World Bank in Washington. We were engaged by UNESCO to develop the global report on the use of ICTs in education for persons with disabilities. More recently, we worked with UNESCAP and developed a guideline manual on inclusive disaster risk reduction, disabilities, and disasters. And we also had a project in Saudi Arabia with the King Abdul Aziz Road for Mecca and Medina. And our colleague Bob Topping worked on developing an illustrated technical guide to accessibility standards for the design of public spaces. So that just gives you an idea of some of the work that we do. Now I'll go back to the speaking about the project with the Delta Center. So the project had two key objectives, was to inform states' parties as they prepare their reports and to foster a higher level of understanding of accessibility and universal design around the world. And Norway saw this as a role that they could take on and a responsibility really that they felt that they could provide some leadership around the world. So as you all know, the UNCRPD has provided a few directions on what should be done. One of them is to establish a focal point in each country and for each country to develop a national strategy. And they're required to report on their progress within 2 years of the date of signing the convention. And they're required to involve persons with disabilities in the development of their country reports and their implementation of the convention in their countries. Okay. So as you, I'm sure all of you know, that the promotion of universal design is a general obligation of for states parties in the UN Convention, and it's defined by Article 2. We have a lovely illustration here that was prepared by Soren Ginnerup from Denmark, which illustrates universal design and how it involves everything from the outside in, getting to a facility, getting in and around about the facility, getting up and down and participating with all of the systems within any built environment situation, that is the audibility of sounds, the provision of wayfinding and signage, the provision of materials in alternate formats and accessible formats, and the information delivery. So those are some of the components, but then there is the last one, which is getting people with disabilities out of a building in an event of an emergency. So that is all of the components that are embrace of universal design. Usually people say something else about it, but I made up my own today. I mean, usually they give you the principles and everything like that. But it's really being able to seamlessly get in, move about, safely participate in all activities, and get out. Okay. So in this report, what they wanted us to do was to examine the CRPD reports that had been submitted by the countries that had already prepared their reports and had signed the convention some time ago. So we actually went about looking at and analyzing what the countries reported on. So the countries, the list, I would just read through it quickly. These were the ones that had reported already. So Australia, Belgium, Canada, China, Denmark, Ecuador, the European Union, Haiti, Iran, Kenya, Korea, Mauritius, Nepal, New Zealand, Qatar, Spain, Sudan, Sweden, and the United Kingdom. So, I guess I've already really said this, that each state's party must submit their report to the committee. Okay, next. Okay. As you know, Article 9 is the key component of accessibility criteria in the convention, but really accessibility is the spinal cord of the convention as it has been described to me. It really is a component in all the articles because accessibility impacts everything. So it really is the overarching article, although there are other dedicated articles such as Article 11 and Article 21 and mobility, and there's now many of them, but most of the countries really look to the requirements in Article 9 when they did their reporting. Okay. So we developed some questions based on what the countries had actually identified as their own key indicators. So we developed questions to see how many countries really responded to these particular issues. So one of the questions was, are courthouses accessible to everybody? Are prisons accessible to persons with disabilities? Is sign language interpretation provided in schools? is funding available to purchase assistive devices? And then we reviewed what every country had said. So we found some interesting things, but I'll just continue on and then I'll get to the findings in a little while. Under the purview of Article 11, situations of risk and humanitarian emergencies, we had two key questions. Do disaster management committees have representation from persons with disabilities? And are emergency warning broadcasts provided in accessible formats with sign language and captioning, audible and visual warning systems? Okay. And Article 20, personal mobility, we asked, are there accessible buses for local transport? And are there standards for accessible parking? And Article 24, education, do children with disabilities have access to mainstream education? And do children with disabilities have access to specialized in education? And are assistive devices and alternate formats available? So we did the analysis. We gathered all of the information from the various country reports. Okay, next. In the toolkit, we also provided some information and guidance to the various states' parties on how to identify key indicators. So Victor will speak to that.
Thank you, Betty. Could you put this a little closer? There we go. So the report, as Betty mentioned, really was conceived as a tool, not only relisting articles of the convention, but actually giving NGOs a way to think about the ways that they can create their own surveys. What we've seen all over the world is that NGOs and nonprofits are increasingly looking to their own data collection efforts, their own monitoring efforts, their own way of compiling evidence on the gaps in implementing the CRPD. And the more help they get to identify what really they are looking for, the more rich and useful the information can be in submitting shadow reports, in submitting evidence to local media, in submitting and collecting this evidence and to create change. So what we realized was that a lot of nonprofits and a lot of advocacy groups really require a basic understanding of data collection. So let's go back, please. Back a couple of slides. The first question is, what is an indicator? And an indicator, next slide, is there are pieces of information that give us insight into matters of large significance and make perceptible trends that are not immediately detectable. Basically, an indicator gives us a small piece of the bigger puzzle. It gives us one understanding, one point of data that together with other points of data let us understand a bigger issue. And what we were finding increasingly in the work that we've been doing is that disability is a multidimensional and multi-layered phenomenon. So accessibility and exclusion requires multiple indicators, multiple ways of looking at the issue of exclusion and accessibility. Next slide. But the data points should help us see from where we are to where we're going and make adjustments. A lot of people also realize that when they're putting together their own goals, the goals need to be able to be measured. And so a lot of nonprofits are using strategic planning methodologies and what is called SMART goals or SMART indicators or SMART measures. And those help nonprofits think about issues in the CRPD that are directly relevant to them and then break down the ways that they can collect evidence. Is that indicator helping you identify specific things that are measurable? Are those things attainable? Are those things relevant to the problem you're trying to solve? And can you try to create some time-bound elements, some time-bound measures? So a specific question is not about, is your city accessible, but specifically, are crosswalks, you know, near schools accessible? Specifically, you know, can you measure certain aspects of that crosswalk? Are they this width? Are they this length? Are there specific issues in terms of time? Will they become accessible when you're talking to governments within 5 years? Will they become accessible within a few months? What are the layers that you need to track in understanding that these elements should be specific, measurable, attainable? You can't create a fully inclusive society. You can never do that. So you need to be very specific to what parts of that puzzle you're trying to solve so that's attainable. Now, what we also saw, next slide, is that there were other tools that we could share with NGOs. And these are specifically issues that help NGOs collect specific positions and experiences that give unique insights. So the role of people with disabilities as experts in accessibility is because of the lived experience of living with a disability gives you insights that can give policymakers new perspectives on the problems they're trying to solve. Sometimes these are too anecdotal, meaning that they're voices of people with disabilities, but they're not enough to just have a bunch of phrases, a bunch of voices. But it is one important element is to include those voices. An example of that is a recent baseline report that is being developed on inclusive urban development, is specifically mandating that the subjective experience of people with disabilities in urban development processes be included into the technical report. The issue of participatory approaches, again, nothing about us without us. Are people with disabilities engaging in developing the programs and the policies and also in measuring them? Next slide. Are these being communicated and interpreted by people with disabilities? Can we also look at these indicators as a way to cross-check things that we're trying to measure in the area of accessibility? You know, are people with disabilities working with the school system to make those schools accessible? Or are the schools becoming accessible just by, you know, one, just the people that work in the Ministry of Education? Are other actors kind of triangulating and cross-checking those efforts? And then empowering people with disabilities in the process to have a bigger stake in the outcome. So this other methodology is not just about the goal, but also the process. And in light of all this, we want to make sure that there's deliberate effort for these indicators to engage and measure the impact of different groups that intersect with this outcome, this goal, or this result that you want to create. How does it affect women? How does it affect children? How does it affect the elderly? These are all groups that also intersect with disability. So you should look at the intersectionality of disability and try to also measure those elements as well. Next slide. So in conclusion, what we did with the report is we gave a few tools to NGOs that they can think about when they start collecting their own evidence. So they think about how to find the pieces to the puzzle. And the puzzle is, why are there so many places that are still not accessible? why are there so many millions of children that are still not going to school? The more NGOs and the more grassroots efforts that are empowered to take ownership of the problem and to push the issue forward, the more progress we will have. Thank you very much.
Okay, so now it's my pleasure to just share with you some of the findings that we found. And this is what the states' parties reported on. It doesn't mean that it's necessarily so. It doesn't mean it's necessarily not so. But it's interesting to see what the states' parties' reports include. And it's also a great source of information for you all to be able to go back and look and see what a particular country is saying that they're doing. And perhaps if you're with an NGO, you can challenge that. Or perhaps if you're also wanting to do the opposite side and support them in what they have reported on. So most of the countries reported that they had Human Rights Act. Most reported that persons with disabilities are involved in developing the CRPD report itself. So that's very good. They reported that technical specifications for accessibility were incorporated into their national building code. So if you want to know if a country has a national building code or has accessibility, you can go to these country reports to see. Or we have copies of the report for you here. So you're welcome to take one. They also, most of them reported that there is a government assistance for the purchase of assistive devices and that access to education and healthcare, accessibility to education and healthcare is a requirement. So those are pretty interesting findings. And then some more. Most countries reported that I say most interestingly, that the right to educational facilities is addressed in the constitutional documents. So that's pretty interesting, particularly if in that country they are not actually constructing new accessible educational facilities. Norway was the only country that reported that they provide funding for NGOs to develop shadow reports. Accessible buses were available for local transport. That was very commonly reported on. And disaster management plans, including persons with disabilities, was unfortunately not something that they mentioned very often. That was definitely a weakness. It doesn't to say that people with disabilities are not involved in it, but the country's not choosing to report on that as part of their compliance with the CRPD. Okay, so that was just a quick overview, but the data and the analysis is available in a report, and I have copies in DAISY and on CD if anybody is interested in those. So that's just a quick overview on this particular project, but we welcome any questions or comments or email back to us if you'd like some more information about this. Thank you. Yes, okay,
I just want to add that we're really at GAATES interested in continuing to move beyond just this report and work with you to continue to expand these indicators, to continue to look at what's happening, to measure accessibility in different parts of the world. And I just want to say a public thank you to my research assistant, Paul Cruz, who really helped us a lot with collecting some of the data for our portion, which is this indicator chapter. So thank you, Buck, for your contribution. That's all.
Thank you, Betty and Victor. Our next speaker is Tom Butcher.
Thank you, Shweb. Can you hear me? Thank you, Shweb, and thank you to GAATES for allowing me to tell you. A wee bit about the Zero Project and what we've been doing. Can I have a sample?
I have the zapper? The slides. Sorry. No, I put it on the thing. Sorry, I beg your pardon. It's called GAATES, GAATES. Thanks. I thought I'd tell you first what we are. The Zero Project has a single, very clear, very simple mission: to work for a world without barriers, according to the principles and articles of the CRPD. Just that, and in the most effective ways that we can. It's an initiative of the ESSEL Foundation, which is a philanthropic foundation established in Vienna, Austria, in 2007 by Martin ESSEL and his wife Gerda. We're helped in our daily work through partnerships with the World Future Council, who joined us in 2011, and the European Foundation Centre, who joined us in 2013. We advance our mission through researching social indicators that both measure the implementation of this CRPD and the current situation in countries around the world, and also through researching and providing a platform to disseminate knowledge about both innovative practices and innovative policies from around the world that help to improve the lives of persons with disabilities. I've just mentioned the word platform. Our aim is also for the Zero Project to provide a platform for the exchange of ideas. And as a collective corpus of knowledge and experience grows, build partnerships through which this can be developed and shared with everyone. We communicate through various media, our annual report, through conferences, the last two of which we held at the UN in Vienna, and which this year, at which this year we hosted over 400 distinguished guests from about 60 different countries. At these, we present the results of our research. There are workshops and discussions, and there are also presentations by those behind some of the most noteworthy innovative practices and policies. And then, of course, there is our website where you can find news, copies of our reports, presentations from and videos of our conferences, together with fact sheets on innovative practices and policies. And then, of course, there's a social media in the form of Facebook, Twitter, and the like. I think it's important to point out that the Zero Project is not actually a legal entity. It's rather a small core team of professionals from the ESSEL Foundation, the World Future Council, and the European Foundation Centre. The expertise really resides in the huge network of all kinds of disability experts from around the world who so readily, willingly, and kindly contribute to our research and work. While we provide the framework, or rather are the machine, it is this network's members who really provide the fuel. In the last 4 years, a total of over 3,000 experts and organizations from more than 150 countries have contributed their time, help, knowledge, and experience in many different ways. And the network continues to grow daily. In terms of geographical reach, from very humble beginnings back in 2010, 2011, when we covered only 15 countries, our 2015 report included coverage of some 150 countries. And we hope to increase this number as time goes on. In the last 3 years, in addition to our basic research, we have also included specific topics on which to focus. We've organized these topics on a four-year cycle, one that kicked off back in 2013 with employment, and most recently addressed the twin issues of independent living and political participation. In the context of the forum today, I thought you might be interested in just a very few of our findings when we looked at accessibility in 2013 for our 2014 report. Our research was based on 20 UNCRPD-based indicators and 12 accessibility-specific indicators. Experts, as they still do, provided answers based on a traffic light system, a green light indicating a yes, an orange light indicating a yes with qualifications, and a red light indicating no. For the 2014 report, 164 experts from 130 countries answered the indicators questionnaire. These were made available in 8 different languages: English, French, Spanish, German, Italian, Russian, Arabic, and Chinese. Looking across the thematic clusters into which our indicators fell that year, apart from education itself, I could identify at least 7 other clusters that had clear bearings on education. These were the built environment, data, emergencies, ICT, personal rights, transport, and university curriculum. In addition to the more obvious ones like accessibility of the built environment with its importance for school buildings, or transport with the ability of disabled children to get to and from school, there were the perhaps less obvious ones. For example, data. If there are no statistics available about how many disabled persons graduate from university, how can you ensure that as many as possible have the opportunity to do so? Or how are persons with disabilities, particularly children, going to cope in the case of an emergency? For an example, an earthquake or tsunami, if they're not provided with the appropriate education. Or for children who, not least as part of growing up, want just to go and watch a soccer match, visit a museum, or watch a film. How will this be possible if no reliable information about the accessibility of venues, etc., is available? And then finally, at a university level, there's always a question as to what extent training for ICT, architectural, and engineering students about inclusive design solutions is mandatory. As if the diversity of these themes was not enough, 4 results selected from across their range are further indicative of the challenges we face. On a primary education level, as a child starts out, there is, of course, the vital issue of inclusion. We asked in our questionnaire, does a child with disabilities have the right to receive free and compulsory primary education within the mainstream educational system? The answers we received across 120 countries consisted of 51 unqualified affirmatives, 60 qualified affirmatives, and 9 categorical no's. I suppose we should take that as encouraging. However, when it came to the availability of official statistics on university graduation, in 82 out of 127 countries, the answer was a categorical no, and there were only 8 unqualified yeses. In only three of 120 countries surveyed, were accessible broadcasting services readily available to all persons with disabilities? The affirmative was qualified in 76 countries, and there was a resounding no from 41 countries. Finally, in only 9 countries was receipt by architectural and engineering students of training about universal design solutions mandatory. I'd not be fair to the wonderful members of our global network, however, if I only mentioned the indicators. Of the 54 selected innovative practices that year, I've chosen just 2, not because they're more innovative than any others, but simply because they address an issue, each addresses an issue that some of us have focused on recently. The first is the evacuation manual in DAISY multimedia format that ATDO, that's the Assistive Technology Development Organization in Tokyo, has developed. It's an easy-to-understand, accessible manual for persons with intellectual disabilities that is customizable for familiar surroundings. This has recently been used to train several groups with the threat of tsunami in mind up in Hokkaido, Japan. With echoes of the importance of listening to the emergency instructions on aircraft, however often you've heard them, one of the trainees is quoted as saying, "First understand how to protect yourself from a tsunami, then memorize it through the evacuation drill. If the brain is panicked, memory will help you to evacuate." The second is a fiercely innovative project being developed by the Manchester Museum in England that, through the creation of a haptic computer technology, enables blind and visibly impaired museum visitors to touch 3D scans of museum artifacts. The objects are digitized and presented with multimedia information support. The scans are so detailed that, according to the magnification used, cracks on the surface can be felt, and it is possible to differentiate materials just from the sound they make. Finally, I shall mention a single policy that touches upon an interesting and pertinent intersect between accessibility and education. This is India's Copyright Amendment Act No. 27 of 2012, which updates and consolidates copyright law and opens up possibilities for persons with disabilities to gain access to information and to make accessible formats available to them without a license and any related payment. To conclude, I'll leave you with our two topics for 2016, education and ICT. Yes, I know, two huge topics, but I believe relevant to today's discussion. From the 36 detailed challenges noted in our team's minutes from the CRPD Committee's General Day of Discussion on Inclusive Education, some 24 items alone started with the words "lack of." And when it comes to ICT, just the general challenges are pretty daunting. These include the complexity of information and communication technologies, the speed of innovation, and just a general lack of awareness of ICT accessibility issues. But I think I'm correct in saying that however big the issues may be, we'll have a go at them. We can only learn by trying and sharing our results. And indeed, our call for nominations and innovative practices and policies will be going out very soon. Thank you for this opportunity to tell you a little bit about what the Zero Project does, and particularly what we've done in the field of accessibility and education.
Thank you, Tom. Are there any questions for any of the panel members here before they leave the podium? Any questions? No questions. Okay, thank you very much to all the presenters. We will call upon Gopal, Betty is here, Janet, Anjali, Vaskar, and Deepak to join us.
Please, is it okay?
Okay.
That's Betty. Well, I am, but it's okay with the
so it takes quite a few minutes to reorganize ourselves on the inaccessible podium. Shall we start? Our next item, our next speaker, well, she's not here. She couldn't make it because... We have the recording, yes. Our next speaker is Mona Mansouri, who is the chairperson of the Gulf Disability Society. The Gulf countries being Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Bahrain, Qatar, UAE, and Oman. And she's the chairperson of that Gulf Disability Society. She's from the UAE, and she couldn't get a visa in time to be here. So we've got a short recording that we're just going to play. Andreas?
إنساني راق وهو خدمة الأشخاص من ذوي الإعاقة وإننا في الجمعية نعمل على التعاون المشترك بين جميع الجهات المعنية على الصعيد العربي والعالمي لتوحيد الجهود المبذولة والبحث عن أفضل الخدمات المقدمة ومتابعة القضايا والتشريعات وأيضا إقامة المؤتمرات والندوات واللقاءات المختلفة التي نسعى من خلالها على تسليط الضوء لأهم القضايا والعمل على وضع الحلول لها من خلال الملتقيات العلمية التي تنظمها الجمعية سنوياً بالتناوب بين دول الأعضاء. ولعل مساهمة الجمعية الخليجية للإعاقة وبالتعاون مع الأمانة العامة لدول مجلس التعاون الخليجي في تبادل القضايا التي تهم الأشخاص ذوي الإعاقة والتسييق المشترك، قام بشكل بارز بالارتقاء بالخدمات المقدمة لهم، كما كان للتوقيع الاتفاقية للعمل المشترك مع منظمة جيتس العالمية أثر كبير في تبادل الخبرات والمشاركات الدولية والوقوف على ما هو جديد في الخدمات المقدمة للأشخاص من ذوي الإعاقة في العالم. يسرني في الختام وباسمي وباسم أعضاء الجمعية الخليجية للإعاقة وعلى رأسهم الشيخ دايج خليفة الخليفة الرئيس الفخري للجمعية الخليجية أن أتقدم بالشكر الجزيل للقائمين على تنظيم هذا المؤتمر، وأقدم اعتذاري لعدم تمكنني من المشاركة والتواجد معكم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
Thank you, Andreas. So our next speaker is Gopal Mitra from UNICEF, who works with Rosangela Bierman. And Gopal used to work for Leonard Chester International. He was the global campaigns manager, but he's now working with Rosangela in the UNICEF focal point on disability. So Gopal, you have the floor. I've got it. But you can use this as well.
I'll use that.
This
one. Here we go.
Okay.
That's why the mic is here. It's easier.
Just a reflection before I get into my remarks proper. When Victor was struggling negotiating with this inaccessible ramp and getting into the stage, I was reminded of a couple of walkthroughs of this building we had, you know, accessibility walkthroughs over the last 1.5-2 years. And there is a capital management plan, and there was a very senior official who was telling us about a lot of the accessibility features. And then when we went around the building, a lot of persons with disabilities from IDA and a couple of us, we started pointing out, oh, this is not accessible, that is not accessible, we have to do this and that. And the next time the walkthrough was organized, we came and there was the same senior official, and we told him, what has happened? Well, you guys, every time I meet you, I end up spending a couple of million dollars, you know, trying to improve. But still, you know, there is so much to be done. And this is the United States of America. When we talk about Guinea-Bissau or Mali or Sierra Leone or Bangladesh or, you know, it puts things into perspective. At the same time, do we start hoping for less? And what do we do? We have sent people to the moon, to space, but majority of children with disabilities still do not go to school, and it's the 21st century. Even when children go to school, children with disabilities lag far behind in learning outcomes as compared to their non-disabled peers. When you speak to children with disabilities, there are girls with disabilities who tell us, we love to go to school, we go to school, you know, but we eat less food because if we do, we have to use the toilet, and that is not accessible, but we love coming to school, so we drink less water, you know. So that's the reality. But at the same time, a couple of weeks back, I had the opportunity of interacting with a child who went to an inclusive school for whom the school was made accessible. And the child from a developing country was narrating that his favorite place in the whole world is his school. He says that I go to a regular school, you know, my classmates, and he's a wheelchair user, He says, my classmates know what to do. If I need books, they take it out of my bag. We play together. And then when these classmates of mine become adults, they will not stare at people with disabilities saying, oh, from which planet have you come, right? So accessibility, we are talking about accessibility. It's one of the key components. It's one of the principles. If you see Article 2F of the convention, it's a principle on which the convention is based. The good part is that what Rosangela mentioned is about the momentum that exists. I think it's like never before. In the World Education Forum, right from the president of the World Bank to the leaders, the executive director of UNICEF, to the president of South Korea, to countless education ministers, mentioned about the need of inclusive education, of addressing the rights and needs of children with disabilities as far as education is concerned. Because if we do not do that, the rest of the world will go ahead and children with disabilities will start going behind. There will be divergence. We talk about inequality. It will perpetrate further inequality. We spoke about SDG 4, which mentions inclusive quality education, mentions about equity. Then accessibility is the key to all of this. But the question is, compared to 10 years back, we used to tell, oh, you need to have accessibility, you need to have inclusive education. But now, what we see is there is increasing willingness, at least if I may say so, to address it. And the question is on us. Tell us how we do it. And we got to, and that's not an easy task. We need to say, we need to provide solutions. How do you promote accessibility within low-resource contexts, within complex emergencies, in humanitarian contexts? At UNICEF, we have been thinking about it. And as a part of our overall disability work, we have started in a systematic way, trying to address issues of accessibility, issues of inclusion. And in the next 5 or 6 minutes, I'll try and outline some of the work that we have been doing around it. And when we talk about accessibility, and especially in the area of education, we're talking about children who cannot access, children with disabilities who cannot go to school, or even when they go to school, they do not learn because the textbooks are inaccessible. They cannot play because the playgrounds are inaccessible. But let's also think about children who have parents with disabilities. You cannot go to the school to attend a parent-teacher meeting. You cannot drop your daughter or son off to school, and so on. So there are a range of issues there. And when we talk about accessibility, we got to understand. And that's what we realize as we work, that it is a part of a complex puzzle with different components. Let's, for example, take education. An accessible school is not enough to guarantee accessibility, access to education, access to learning. We got to start with, how does a child reach school? What about the commute? Does that girl or a boy need an assistive device, a hearing aid, a wheelchair, a white cane? And then you see that, oh, the cane is given by, or the hearing aid is given by the social welfare department. But to get that hearing aid or the cane, you need a disability certificate, which is given by the health department. The toilet in the school is built by the public works department, right? So there comes the question of all of us working together. We talk about multi-sectoral approach, and that is one of the keys. It's not easy, you know, people protect their turfs, their territory, and so on, we heard. But unless we are able to find solutions to all this, it does not seem that we can go far ahead, but the bright part is that the momentum is there like never before. Now, coming to UNICEF's work, we have been trying to address issues of access, accessibility, across 3 or 4 components in a systematic way. We're talking about policies. Rosangela was mentioning about the executive directives. We are talking about creating Once you have a policy, how do you implement? You need capacity, you need knowledge, you need tools. After that comes supplies. So how do you ensure that actually the physical nuts and bolts of supplies are accessible? How do you ensure that the programs, the interventions, take into account all of this? And at the end, how do you monitor? How do you track progress? Talking about the policies, Rosangela mentioned about two executive directives that UNICEF is currently working on, and it's in the final stages. One of the directives talks about accessibility of any construction, any program-related construction that UNICEF is involved with, whether it's a school, a health center, any public facility. Even when, and it concerns new facilities, remodeling, repair, anything, accessibility has to be built into all such projects. Even when UNICEF is not directly implementing, and in so many instances today, agencies are not implementing themselves, but are on the table negotiating. So in any of these, accessibility has to be considered. We are talking about laying down minimum standards. We are talking about international standards, adhering to international standards and so on. And within the system, we are trying to fix responsibilities and so on. So these are some of the policy work at the policy level, what we are trying to do. And coming to the capacity, to knowledge, we are working closely with GAATES to develop a comprehensive toolkit on accessibility, covering components like universal design, explaining what accessibility is, putting together technical specifications in a simple, usable way, putting together knowledge on how to advocate for accessibility for UN agencies who are there, for UNICEF who is there on the table, negotiating with governments, with partners, with development partners. How do you advocate? What is the justification and so on? We are developing technical samples of accessible schools and so on. With these knowledge resources, we feel that we can find solutions. We can provide solutions to our colleagues on ground who are working on accessibility. The how part. Coming to supplies. And let me talk about a minute about emergencies. I know Deepak is here from Nepal, which has recently witnessed a huge earthquake. UNICEF has a lot of kits which are used in emergency context. We are reviewing those kits. We have reviewed the components of these kits, like school in a box, which are deployed in emergency situations. They were not accessible. We have tried to incorporate universal design features into the school in the box, as well as add guidance for facilitators to include children with disabilities in the using that school in the box. And why is it important? It's not only important for children in emergency situations to go to school or to attend temporary learning facilities, but these are also spaces where other valuable interventions like nutrition, like vaccinations are given. So if a child, if a boy or a girl with disability misses out on the temporary learning space, she also misses out on nutrition. She also misses out on vaccinations. We are trying to review all our supplies from a universal design point of view. We just completed with GAATES a survey on assistive technology in which we are trying to identify what are the most critical assistive devices, technologies which are required for children with disabilities to participate in school and more largely in the community. Based on that, we are trying to develop a product guide which can facilitate procurement and supply of assistive devices by UNICEF partners worldwide. Megan and I, we are working closely on it under the guidance of Rosangela with GAATES. So these are some of the interventions that we are trying to do. Also important is what we are trying to do to make the learning environment accessible. Children with disabilities go to school, but the books are not accessible. Books are rarely available in accessible formats for a child who is deaf, who is blind, or a child who has who has an intellectual disability. We are trying to working on an initiative on which we can call as a universal design for learning. To ensure that we use innovations and technology to ensure that when a textbook or a learning material is published, it is simultaneously available in audio and text format for those who are blind, in sign language, tagged with text for those who are deaf or hard of hearing, in simplified formats for those who have intellectual disabilities. And we are working currently with a whole range of partners to develop protocols to convert regular textbooks into these formats, because at this point of time, such format protocols do not exist. We are working on an application, a universal learning application, which will pull together all these formats and can be played on a variety of mainstream devices. I have here a card which has a QR code. And if you have a mobile phone with a QR reader, you can access a book. If you scan the QR reader, which is an application which is available free of cost, you can access a book. And in this case, the Ugly Duckling book, which in sign language and in text. And this learning is not only valuable for children with disabilities, but it will enhance learning outcomes for all children. I'll request my colleague Anna to just give you a flavor of it in like 30 seconds.
El patito feo, qué raro. Los patitos siempre son hermosos. Vamos a ver. Raro era el huevo que apareció en el nido de mamá pata. Rarísimo. Más raro que no sé qué.
We got a book like this to study when we went to school. Learning becomes so much more fun, you know. But the point is, when we are working towards it, we need to ensure that these are all scaled up. We need to ensure that we are doing things right. So we are investing a considerable amount of time. For example, if this book, the book in sign language, will be a recording of a teacher for the deaf teaching a book in sign language, so that in terms of pedagogy, in terms of learning, it caters to the learning needs of children with disabilities. We can discuss more of this bilaterally, but to end, let me also talk briefly about a piece on data. So all these things are happening. How do we monitor progress? How do we track? The SDGs are there. They are coming. Last year, UNICEF did a review of 40 countries with terms and looked at the education management information system. That is the main data collection worldwide done on education. We reviewed EMIS forms from 40 countries, and more than half did not have any mention on disability. And the half that did, it was very sketchy. So we developed a guide to strengthen data collection. So if accessibility is there, how do we measure? How do we know it's there or not there? If learning materials are available, how do you track progress? How do you capture that information? So we have to be very, very careful to ensure that we capture all of this information in the data pieces that exist on education. Otherwise, we'll never be able to track progress. We'll never be able to justify investment, right? So we are doing a significant amount of work in all these areas. But all these are interconnected, and it's building these, connecting these dots, which are so important. And at the center of it, lay or are children, boys and girls with disabilities, young people with disabilities who should be center of this work. And we are also trying to ensure that. Because at the end of the day, it is girls and boys with disabilities who we are trying to develop all these for. And and that is where comes the importance of working together, working in partnership. At UNICEF, we remain committed to work with all of you to ensure that when we go to a school, we see in a school of 100 children, at least 10 or 15 children with disabilities studying. And we have to make that a reality. And we look forward to working with all of you. And thank you, GAATES, for this organizing this forum. Thank you.
So Betty is going to continue talking about the relationship and the working relationship between UNICEF and GAATES. But before you do that, Betty, let me just introduce all the speakers on the panel so that we have an idea of who's here, because the speakers on the panel are going to follow Betty's introduction, talking about their work that GAATES has been doing in partnership for UNICEF. The first person that I want to introduce is Janet Jimenez from Mexico, who is an architect and she's a consultant on accessibility for people with disabilities, consulting on access to the built environment, public spaces, public transport, assessment and writing of technical specifications, training seminars. And she wrote the draft of the accessibility standard for services in Mexico and a design guideline to complement the standard. And currently she's involved in research about accessible public transport in small vehicles and participation for the manual of traffic control devices. Okay, that's Janet. Then the next person I want to introduce on the panel is Anjali Agarwal. She's a researcher from India. She's also a consultant in accessibility and she's well known in the Asia Pacific region. She's been involved in various UN consultations on accessibility, on education and tourism. And she's regularly nominated by the government of India as an expert to advise on programs and policies relating to universal access. Then I would like to introduce to my left here, Vaskar Batterjee from Bangladesh. He's a program manager of the Young Power in Social Action. He also serves as a focal person for DAISY, the Digital Accessible Information System. He's worked as a national consultant on web accessibility with access to information programs under the Prime Minister's Office in Bangladesh. And then finally, I'd like to introduce from Nepal, Deepak, who is an architect from Nepal, and he's currently working for the Independent Living Center in Kathmandu. And he's involved in the disability movement in Nepal, and also he's the GAATES representative in Nepal, the country rep. So that is briefly the list of speakers. So Betty, I hand it over to you.
Thank you, Shwaib. Well, first of all, I'd like to say that it's a great pleasure for GAATES to be working with UNICEF on this very important initiatives and supporting their executive directives and their policy changes. It really, for us, is a dream come true. When we created GAATES 8 years ago, this was exactly what we hoped that we would be able to do, is to partner with other organizations and to introduce or develop accessibility and universal design policies and practices and really see them implemented around the world. So it's a thrill for us to be working with them. So we're doing a multifaceted program with them, primarily looking at, built environment elements that relate to the design of schools, as well as the design of premises, of UNICEF premises around the world. We're looking at provision of information for the learning environment in alternate formats and the provision of information and communication technologies. We're looking at assistive devices And we're also developing some model school accessibility plans. So we have a number of different initiatives, but my colleagues, who are all GAATES representatives, who are all working on the project, are really better able than I to share with you some of the work that they've been doing. Could we have my presentation, please, Andreas? It's on the memory stick. Well, we don't have to have it. I can just talk. Okay, so we're going to have presentations from the various country reps on various aspects of the work that we're doing with UNICEF. But what I was going to talk about was one aspect that Gopal alluded to, and that is the use of assistive devices and the availability of assistive devices around the world. So UNICEF asked us to develop a questionnaire, an online questionnaire, that was going to provide some mapping of the provision of assistive devices in school environments. We hear about the use of them or the lack of availability of assistive devices to enable children who are lucky enough to go to school, because of course we know that that the majority of children with disabilities don't go to school. So for the children that do go to school, well, they were interested in knowing about is that the one? You got one? Yes, that's the one. You do have it. Okay. All right, I don't need mine. Okay, so I entitled my presentation The Mosaic of Accessibility, but primarily I'm going to talk about the assistive devices components because the other panel members are going to speak to the other issues. Okay. So, as we mentioned before, accessibility is a continuum of all kinds of aspects of life from the beginning to the end and from the moment you go out the door and try to get to school through to actually accessible transportation, the accessibility of information within the school, the teacher training, the size of the classroom, the access to websites, the provision of assistive devices, and then playing with your colleagues and learning in an inclusive way. So accessibility is a multifaceted mosaic. Okay, universal design we've already spoken about, that it is in Article 2 and it's a general principle for the convention. But really all articles include some components of accessibility. Okay, I did already speak about this, that mosaic of getting in, out, and around. So I'll just move on to actually talking about the education aspects. So accessibility is critical to learning and prospering. We hear this so often from children, from adults who have grown up either being integrated into mainstream school and how that affected their life. And opened so many possibilities for them. We also hear from people who were segregated, sent to separate schools, segregated and denied education, and how without an education they could never get a job and they could never actually thrive. So it really is accessibility provides that opportunity not only to learn but to share and to grow with your fellow students and to prosper in life. So the two main topics that UNICEF asked us to focus on were their premises to make sure that all the UNICEF offices around the world were accessible, and to look at their program-related construction. And last week I got an email from Gopal asking, and Megan asking me to review some drawings for a new school in Sudan. And so I did do so, and it was exciting to see that they had considered some aspects of accessibility in the design of the school, primarily for students with mobility disabilities and primarily wheelchair users, but they also had introduced other components. Excuse me. One of the reasons why UNICEF contacted us and wanted to work with us was because the GAATES can bring an international perspective on accessibility. We have the technical expertise, not just in the built environment or the ICT, but also in learning materials, as well as assistive devices and information and communication technologies. We cross all of that gambit of accessibility. Also, and I'm delighted to say, we have this unique grassroots expertise from our country reps who are here at the podium, who have the experience working in their own countries, and in many cases are people who have grown up with a disability and experienced the education system. So GAATES was able to bring quite a wide band of expertise to the project. Oh, I've put the names here, but we don't need to dwell on this because Schwabe's already introduced everybody. Okay. So one of the things we did do was we initiated a global survey report on assistive devices. Because UNICEF wanted to recognize that technologies are a great equalizer for kids with disabilities, and they maximize opportunities and reduce obstacles. Of course, they don't just, you know, come out of the air. Assistive devices must be assessed to suit the students with a disability. They must be purchased and maintained and repaired if possible. I mean, excuse me, repaired within the country that the devices are, and they must be monitored, and the people and the teachers must be trained to use them. So it's a complex picture. Okay, next. Okay, so we developed a questionnaire. The UNICEF's objective was to assess the importance of assistive devices and technologies and to assess the degree to which they are available. We developed a questionnaire and we sent it to a potential audience of more than 60,000 people via GAATES and UNICEF's distribution network. As you may know, GAATES maintains a global accessibility news service which sends out news every week to over 20,000 people around the world. So that was one of our key distribution mechanisms. The questionnaire was divided into sections covering devices for each of six disability categories: learning and cognitive, blind and low vision, deafness and hard of hearing, mobility, dexterity, and communication. The availability of assistive devices and their repair and maintenance turned out to be a huge issue. We asked people to identify the 10 most commonly used assistive devices. And the response rate was actually considered to be quite good. We got 180 responses from over 50 countries. So some of the findings. One of the findings that was very interesting to us was that all six disability groups were addressed fairly consistently. So that's kind of a surprise to us. When you look at accessibility of the built environment, you don't get that kind of a mix of all of the various disability groups being recognized. And historically, this has been a big problem, that people with disabilities such as developmental disabilities, and people with hearing impairments, et cetera, were at the bottom of the line, the back of the line when it came to obtaining assistive devices. So this was a very good finding that we had, was that all disability groups were addressed fairly consistently. Computers, software, hardware, and low-tech devices, such as adaptive play equipment, were considered important in every region. That was also a little bit surprising. There are more people that are using things like iPads and other adaptive software or hardware. But respondents rated the provision of things like a ball holder or a page turner as equally as important. So low-tech as well as high-tech. Now, the responsibility for the provision of assistive devices fell between governments, NGOs, and families. In the more high-income countries, the governments more frequently provided assistive devices free of charge. But the mix, as we went to some of the middle development countries and things, was not, it was not too surprising. I mean, in the low-income countries who had less funds available, they were more apt to provide some of the low-tech devices. But things such as wheelchairs and hearing aids received the highest rating from right across the board, regardless of the income level of the country. Okay. Repair and maintenance was a huge issue. Many countries reported that they had assistive devices that had been purchased by the school boards. They didn't have adequate training for their school teachers, and they didn't have adequate training to train the kids on how to use these devices. And then when they broke down, well, that was the end. They all went into the room at the end of the hall where nobody ever went. So repair and maintenance of assistive devices was a huge issue, and every economic group or region responded to this question. So it, even though one might think that it would be more of a problem in some of the lower income countries, it was not so. It was considered important in them all. The other interesting thing was that the responsibility for the repairs, as opposed to the purchase of these devices, fell on the family. So the school board might buy the device, or somebody may provide the hearing aid or the wheelchair, but when it came to repairing them, the responsibility fell on the family. So that was really kind of a shocking finding. Certainly this is what we hear from the various families, though. Okay. Important devices. Oh, dear. Problem with the slide there. Probably transferring. But I've already said in order of importance, manual wheelchairs and assistive listening devices and hearing aids, followed by computer hardware and software and listening systems, rated as the most important, and Braille and pictures and objects, learning materials, then were followed. Okay. So who financed assistive devices? In low-income economies, NGOs played a very important role. So that was very interesting to UNICEF to find that out. So clearly working with the local NGOs is very important in supporting children in schools. Families play an important role in financing assistive devices of assistive technology in all economic groups. Government provides financial support for the majority in higher income economies. And in very few countries is any one source mentioned as the sole source for assistive devices. So UNICEF was very interested in this. They're continuing to analyze the data, and we will be issuing a report. So next, please. There were a few limitations, as there are with any survey. In most developing countries, all but the simplest assistive devices were difficult or impossible to source locally. This is a big problem. If you can't get it locally, then you have to pay more, also you have to pay for the duties and the import tax, and it becomes so much more complex. So that was an important finding. If such devices were available in country, they are most likely only readily available in major urban centers. Well, that was not a surprise. That's so for all of us with all assistive devices, I think. So, in conclusion, the pathway to education and the use of assistive devices are integral to the success and prospering of kids with disabilities. So we don't have this final report for you here, but we will have it, and it'll be on the GAATES website, and it will be on UNICEF's site. But we're just, UNICEF is continuing to do some analysis. And we will be presenting this report in Copenhagen in June, where we're working with the supply division of UNICEF, who will be purchasing devices for kids around the world. So that's my presentation. I only focused in on this one aspect, although I'm working with all these lovely people on all of the aspects of the work that we do. And so I leave it to them to describe their sections and their work. Thank you.
Thank you, Bridget. The next speaker is Janet. Janet, you have the floor.
Good afternoon. Yes, I am Janet. I am the country representative of Mexico for GAATES. They already introduced me, so I will skip this slide. So GAATES is working with UNICEF on a project, which is a technical guide for creating inclusive schools. It is about the physical accessibility to schools, and I have been involved in this project. Sorry. So I will show you one of the case studies that I did in Mexico City. This is an urban, regular, primary, private school of about 150 families. The owners of the school are the administrators, and they rent the premises, the land, and the building. Therefore, the administrators have to pay for any renovation, including any accessibility feature. So funds need to come from their own resources and depend on their yearly budget. The administrators, The administrators are the parents of a boy with a mild neurological condition. So since the beginning, they thought about the concept of an inclusive school. They have low tuition fees, comparing to other schools in that area. So therefore, they have a diverse community with students with a different economic and social backgrounds. They knew that if they wanted to accept students with disabilities, they had to do a physical accessible school. But it just happened that a girl on a wheelchair wanted to attend that school, so it was accepted, and they knew that they had to do it accessible. It just happened that the girl of the wheelchair student is an architect with knowledge on accessibility. So the first thing that the architect did was an access audit. At that time, there were no accessibility standards for school in Mexico. Now we have. So after the access audit, the architect went together with the administrators and did an accessibility plan. They knew since the beginning that they couldn't do immediately all the changes, that it will have to go in stages. So the first thing that they did was to install the main entrance ramp, and they put a temporary ramp in a classroom. Later on, they managed to put a lift, and they changed the use of rooms. For example, the library was upstairs, and they changed it to downstairs. And later on, they took out the temporary ramp and made accessible another school classrooms. So everything was in the stages. They will change the layout of the school. But the most difficult bit is to do the accessible toilets facilities. So as you can see, it has been gradually physical changes in parallel to other administrative changes. For example, the school schedules a monthly parents' capacity building session, and they have an inclusion award yearly for the staff or for the teachers or for the students or for the parents. So the main core is about accessibility continuum. This drawing shows basically the accessible routes and the use of the thing of each element. So one of the first things to know is how do students reach the school? Do they arrive walking? Do they arrive in a public transport? Do they arrive in a private vehicle? And how do they reach to the main entrance of the school, which is number 2? In this drawing, number 3 is about how do they move around the school. Number 4 is how do they reach the classroom and how do they use that classroom. Number 5 is how do they reach the support rooms, for example, the library. Number 6 is how do they reach the drinking facilities. Number 7 is how do they reach the hand washing facilities. Number 8 is how do they reach the toilet facilities. And as you can see in this school, number 7 and number 8 are in a separate building and just close by to the playground, which is number 9. So I'm going to show you some of the pictures of the school. So number 1, which is approaching the school, you can see in the pavement marked in yellow, which are the drop-off areas for the vehicles. And you can see also there is a bus stop just around the corner. So how do students arrive? Is there an accessible route all the way to the entrance? Number 2 is entering the school. There are 2 images. The images at the left-hand side shows the door, which is not the ideal width of the door, but it is acceptable. And at the right-hand side, you can see the first ramp that it was built, which was the entrance ramp to the school. Number 3, you can see in this image, what's the circulation just outside the classroom? So this is moving around the school. And at the right-hand side, you can see a lift, which there was a lot of issues about the lift. First of all, the cost of the lift, the safety of the lift, and the maintenance. So in this case, they managed to install a low-cost lift, and the maintenance is done by the school maintenance department, so they don't need to bring somebody external to the school to do the maintenance. Number 4 is using a classroom. In this picture, you can see that there is a girl on a wheelchair and that she has a wider desk. But one of the issues here is to maneuver inside the classroom. Number 5, in this image, you will see the library. So how do I use that library? Can I reach the books? Can I reach the computer? And, well, they just talk about the materials, which that's another issue. Number 6 is using the drinking water facilities. Here you can see that it's a very simple system. It's a very big bottle with a dispenser. Number 7 is using the hand washing facilities. There are the wash basin are accessible. They have the right height. However, there are some details that they are still missing. For example, the tap control. Number 8, you can see the using toilet facilities. In this image, you can see that there is a WC, which just beside it, there is a transfer area for wheelchair, and they have grab bars, horizontal grab bars. Number 9, you can see the playing area, which is the playground, and there is no problem there. There is no changes of level. It is quite flat. But we already talked about the access, but what about egress in case of an emergency? So in this image at the left-hand side, you can see that there are arrows painted on the floor to show which is the evacuation routes. And at the right-hand side, you can see that there is a manual extinguishing equipment for fire. And at the top, there is an audible and visual alarm signal. So what's the content of the UNICEF technical guide? Well, it gives an introduction to inclusive schools and concepts. But one of the main challenges is to convert existing schools to accessible. So it talks about the reasonable accommodation. Afterwards, it talks about the accessibility continuum, all these elements that I just talked to you about before. And at the end, it has the key accessibility requirements, which these are more technical and more detailed. And they are based on the ISO standard 21542, which talks about the built environment and accessibility. It is a table which is shown at the bottom of this slide, which the first column talks about an element, for example, a door. Then it talks about the specification, the design requirements, for example, the width of the door. But then at the last column, it makes the reference at the ISO standards. In which paragraph does it say that specification? So we're really looking forward for the publication of this technical guide. Thank you.
Thank you, Janet. Our next speaker is Anjali.
Good afternoon, everyone. Namaste from India. I am the country representative of GAATES from India. And the topic of my presentation is from exclusion to inclusion, looking at the challenges and the solutions that we can provide in the built environment. My presentation contains key principles of accessible education, some myths and facts, gender parity, case studies, and recommendations. I've tried my best to make this presentation very, very accessible because the presentation is on accessibility, but the focus is also the diverse audience in the room so that GAATES mandates that whatever the images are there are also explained well so that people with diverse disabilities can understand that. The key principles of infrastructure entitlements are barrier-free and non-discriminatory, universal accessibility so that the usage is by the maximum people, children with disabilities, people with reduced mobility, whether they are staff with disability or without disability in the school, the visitors and the old people who are coming to the school, the full participation of children with disabilities. And we are looking in a very big way that how, if there's an enrollment, the retention rate should be good. It's just not that we get our children with disabilities admitted because there's a law in the country that says primary education should be accessible and all children with disabilities should be admitted. But what about the retention rates? And there are issues such as accessible toilets, especially for girls who are attaining puberty, and the issue of menstruation hygiene management, where many girls tend to drop out. I'm also looking at design for diversity, school and within the learning spaces, in the classrooms and playgrounds as well. I have a picture right now on the slide that shows that the whole school environment is full of barriers and it's discriminatory because the classrooms are provided on the first floor and there's a child with disability who's supposed to climb the first floor to get to the class. There's another picture where the taps are provided too high and the child with reduced mobility using a ground mobility device cannot access the tap. and hence she goes without water throughout the day. So the question is, for how many days the children with disabilities can actually access school in this kind of a situation? Definitely there will be reasons of dropping out and staying at home again. Universal accessibility, usability and functionality of all elements, it's mandatory. It's just not, we tend to provide an element which is accessible, but then if the regulations are there not to maintain it, the funds are not available, it will not remain functional and it will not be used. So here in the picture, there's a ramp which has been provided to the toilet, but that's not all. The signage, the wayfinding, the handrails, the tactile paving, lower wash basins and taps, which can be used by children having weak fingers, is also important. So it's the question of full participation. It's a question of being treated as equal, not special, so that every setting within the school, whether there's a playground, whether there's a library, or there's a small canteen, children can enter, access, and egress without any issue. It's a design for diversity in school and learning spaces. The picture that I have it on the slide right now is a handrail, which is provided on a ramp, but it's being also used as a play device. With a child with disability and without disability, all children are playing together. And it's just that we create elements that are used by everybody, and it gives so much of fun mingling together and growing together. There's a myth which is attached to accessibility, and many times most of the countries do provide funding for making schools accessible, but they provide funding just for the ramp or the so-called handicapped toilet. But the fact is that it's not just about ramp or accessible toilet. It's about diverse access needs of children with disabilities. It's that everyone must access all areas, including road, approach, services and facilities, playground, everything. Another myth that we have found is that accessibility is considered as a costly proposition, and people think that it requires a lot of funds, like what Gopal said, that retrofitting this building required a lot of millions of dollars. But the fact is, if you do a refurbishment of an existing building, then the cost can be 1 to 2% of the total project cost. But if it is planned from the very beginning, then the cost is negligible. And there are studies in the past that have showed that access standards should be provided in the planning stage, in the blueprint stage, rather than doing retrofittings that turned out to be not fully accessible or not 100% accessible to all children with disabilities. There are case studies that we found, and we did a lot of research to see that there's a gender parity within the schools, where this is a data from India that shows that there are 94 girls to 100 boys, non-disabled children. It's the 2013-14 data. And in the 2012-13, the children with disabilities, there are 77 girls to 100 boys. So what's happening? Where are these girls? Why are they missing from the schools? The reason behind is that there are a lot of issues concerning girls with disabilities, such as not only accessibility, but also the issues of privacy, the issues of equality, and issue of safety. So I'm going to quickly give you some pictures of what is happening in the schools, what are the barriers which we found which are common. The first thing is independent and safe commuting to the schools. Some of the governments we have found in developing countries, they provide vehicles to girls who are non-disabled. For example, in this picture, we are showing that there are girls using cycles because they come from rural areas and the schools are far off from their homes. But what happens to children with disabilities? They would require accessible transportation means to commute. It could be a private vehicle which is adopted by means of providing a lift, or it could be a public transportation system having a ramp where many children with disabilities can access. And there could be timings fixed for pickup and drop to the school so that the parents are not hassled and they do not get bound with children with disabilities. This is very interesting, and I'm sure you can make it out what is the fault here. The picture shows that there's a ramp area which has been completely blocked by a grill. and the access to the school is provided by means of steps. Because usually what we do is a tick mark approach. We say that we have a checklist and it says, is there a ramp? Yes, there's a ramp. So we tick it mark. Yes, but the ramp is not usable because it's been blocked. So I think what is more important is that once the retrofitting happens or if it's a new school, there's a continuous monitoring mechanism, supervision, and involvement of people with disabilities, including parents of children with disabilities, so that they know whether the facilities are usable, they are friendly, or they are safe. Now, there's another very interesting picture where we have Mani, who is climbing a very high drinking water tap, and she said that she slipped twice and have fractured toe fingers. It's simple that the school management has been seeing her climbing up that high a tap to get access to the water. What they could have done is just lower down one of the taps, and it would have helped not only Mani, who is short-stretchered, but also many children who use an assistive device like a wheelchair or a ground mobility device. The second picture is about Rishi. He is dependent upon his friends, his class fellows, to go up and down the school building because there are no handrails. And what does he do every day? Rishi offers his lunch to his classmates. And he said that he has not taken lunch for the last 3 years. So you can imagine sitting in the classroom for 4 to 5 hours every day without taking lunch, all children taking lunch, and he's just sacrificing because he's giving it to his friends so that they can help him go up and down as there are no handrails. This is Ashi, a young kid in the third standard. There are drinking water issues. There are hand pumps provided in schools in the rural areas. One, that the groundwater is not safe to drink. Second, that the hand pump was too heavy for her to operate. And if there are two children, it's still doable, but if there's just one child operating it, how will the Ashi operate the hand pump and drink water simultaneously? It's a question mark which is left to the school management to decide how Ashi can access water. Well, in this picture, it's quite obvious that there are boys sitting in the front and the girls at the back. There are girls with disabilities as well, and there's Shoma, who wants to become a scientist, but she is having low vision, and she said, while I'm sitting at the last desk, I cannot see the blackboard. I cannot read what the teacher is writing on the blackboard. And she said, I want to become a scientist. The only thing what the teacher can do is just give me a front row so that the readability is better. And this is what is required. It's not about gender equality only, but it's also about the sitting arrangement of boys and girls and the non-disabled and the disabled children sitting together so that it's paired. And there's also an experience of disability, learning together, playing together, growing together, and developing together. So the recommendations are, whenever there are allocation of funds for access elements, we must see that it's incorporated in the tender conditions. And it's important that there's a sensitization and capacity building trainings given to the last person who's on the field. If it is a junior engineer, if it is a mason, he also should understand why we are providing handrails on both sides of the ramp. Why should there be some tactile texture so that one understands what is the use and how it's going to be used. Operations and maintenance is the biggest issue. There should be fund allocated for operation maintenance and regular supervision. And it's very important that there should be regular access audits by people with disabilities to see that whatever has been provided, it's also usable and friendly. I'm just going to give quickly one case study of toilets, because when we spoke to the girls with disability, this was a major issue. Here we have a young girl, Hema, who is from class 2, and she just stopped going to the school because there was a very high step to the toilet, and she said that she cannot access the toilet because there's no ramp. And she said the only thing what is required that I can access it at least 2 to 3 times a day. And what needs to be done is just not a ramp to the classroom, but a ramp to the toilet is also very important. Here, there's a picture of a real unsafe practices where many developing countries are having toilets for the boys, but no toilets for the girls. And we have seen that the girls go in pair. One girl keeps standing outside. The second one goes inside. And if there's a man or a boy approaching the toilet, the first one who's standing outside, cue the one who's inside. And the second one inside just quickly dresses her up and come out. So it's a whole issue of lack of privacy, safety, and security. And what happens during the menstruation days, they just tend to stop going to schools. This is a picture of 100 girls, almost 100 girls, dropout girls with speech and hearing impairment from one school of Orissa in India. And the girls are demanding that we want to be educated and we want to be empowered. It's just that the schools need to be made accessible, sensitivity and awareness needs to be done. And it's very important that we should have girls' toilets which are accessible. I just had a bad experience in this building also today that there was an accessible toilet provided in the women's loo and an accessible toilet in the male's loo. And I'm being assisted by a male colleague. I had an issue that he is the most privileged man to enter a female toilet because there was no other way I could use the toilet. So these are the issues which are very important, that detailing and user-friendliness of an element needs to be done. We are also talking about just not providing accessible toilet in terms of urban situations where children are using wheelchairs, but also we need to look at children who are in the rural areas or the semi-urban areas where there are no roads and they use assistive devices. So squatting toilets are very important. So the end of the presentation, I just want to give a few recommendations which were taken as part of the technical guide which we developed for UNICEF, is that we look at the whole school infrastructure accessibility, retrofitting and new construction should be looked at. Independent usage and safety never should be compromised. Gender-friendly designs are important. Weatherproof environment. If there is a country where there's a lot of snow, rainfall, or is it a desert, we need to see what kind of weatherproof situations are given. Use of indigenous material. We do not have to use steel and expensive material. It could be just wood or bamboo, or just chairs which are converted into adapted seats can be made use of. The facility should be functional. It should not be that once it's been provided and it's been locked, so that the provision is there, the money has been spent, but it's not usable. And regular maintenance, which is very important. Thank you very much. And I just wanted to say thank you in a very inclusive way, manner by putting up the sign language here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Anjali. Our next speaker is Bhaskar.
Come? Yeah. And also I need this speaker.
Do you need this one?
The mic will do.
Microphone.
Gates.
I think. Window there. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I think you are listening a lot. So if Gates invite you in a dinner without any food, what will happen? So we are just inviting the children in his school without any books, in alternative format. This is the biggest challenge in the developing world. Believe me, as a student with disabilities, as a visual disability, I never ever got a single book in accessible format. But I got the highest degree from the university. That is really unfortunate. I can't say I received a proper education. I can't say that. I just achieved a certificate. Yes, definitely there is some beauty of disabilities, like we have some other exposure, that's why you have learned. So we had a very small dream. All children will read by 2015. I would like to show you some accessible books, then I will go for my presentation.
Gabe is Gabe.
You can see.
A, Adobe Reader X, A, Amos. Enter.
Amos, I'm not sure.
Section.
I think you are seeing the books. You can't?
A. Leaving Amos desktop. Look, desktop. Oh, listen and say, good morning.
Good morning.
A. Look, no, listen and say, good morning. Good morning.
Now you can see the books? No? I don't know why.
Leaving Amos, desktop. Desktop, folder view, list, alt, tab, Amos.
You cannot see, no? Okay, I can try. I think now you can see if my. Yeah. Now you can see it. Yeah. I think the boss of the accessible reading materials, Ms. Hiroshi Kawamura-san, is here. When I was just told him that Kawamura-san, I never got a books in accessible format to read. This is my dream that all children will read in my country without any barrier. He just told me, this is not your dream, this is our dream. And our dream really came true. I'd like to start with a success story. That is, our government have converted all the books, class grade 1 to grade 10, in accessible format. All the books converted into Unicode, all the books converted into accessible e-books, all the books converted into full text, full audio DAISY books, all the books converted into digital braille, and all the books converted into last print. That's why all children now can access books in their chosen format. I'm not sure you're seeing in the screen or not.
Press space to open the book.
Enter.
Design. National curriculum.
This is the books we are talking about. DACA. This book can be read by seeing. You are now seeing the Bengali text. As we don't have the high-quality text-to-speech, we use the human voice.
Has been revised in the light of the National Education Policy 2000.
So, this is the way that any children can read. And even these books are using in the multimedia classroom. The blind teachers are using these books for teaching the non-disabled children. And same time, I would like to share one of my experience. My daughter, she's only 7 years old. Each day she came with her printed books to me and asked me, Papa, please read for me these books. I always said, please go to your mom. Now we have a digital books. My daughter come to me, I open my laptop and she can read, I can listen. This is the universal design. This is for where GAATES are working. Now come to the our presentation. Now, okay. GAATES, you know, it is an international organization with lots of expertise all over the globe. GAATES have a country representative and expertise who are working on the accessibility issues. And a part of GAATES, I have been working with the UNICEF projects for this accessible reading materials and inclusive educations. You know, GAATES have a lots of contribution to the UN Convention, especially accessibility issues. GAATES have been working with the, especially for the information communication technology, built environment, disaster management, etc. You can find about GAATES to our website, www.gaates.org. As a GAATES country representative, I have been engaged with different national level and international level advocacy. Very soon you will see a picture that our Prime Minister was oriented on the information communication technology. And I talked about the GAATES with her and talked about the how to make a digital Bangladesh with the technical support of different experts from GAATES. And you will be very happy to know that Bangladesh is now building a new country with an inclusive digital Bangladesh. 24,000 websites now almost accessible. I can't say fully accessible, but still UN building toilets are not accessible. How I can think that Bangladeshi all website will be accessible? Yes, 24,000 websites, at least visually impaired people can access. So this is, we use the GAATES resources for that. And I can say there is other picture you are seeing. As a GAATES representative, I have been working in my country. So now come to the point, you know, I told you that inclusive education is our dream. Still, we are very far from this inclusive education. If we'd like to ensure the inclusive education, we require the technology and especially accessible reading materials. Without information communication technology, it is nearly impossible to ensure all children's inclusion in the schools. Books and other printed materials is very difficult to the providing, ensuring in accessible format. So that's why we are just proposing to convert it in such a way that any people can read, write, and understand the content. And there is two things. When you are talking about the mainstreaming education, there is a challenge for the neurodevelopment disabilities. So you need the curriculums and materials such a way that neurodevelopment disability can access. We are talking about the we have a dream. Whenever there is a printed books, that should be available same time, same cost, without any delay. People with children with disabilities can read that. We have some challenges. It should be in time and information communication technology. Cost also our fact. If we have a common standard, then cost will minimize. We are talking about the alternative format, that is Braille, e-books, multimedia books, large screen, etc. I think I will not go details how to make it Braille production, but I would like to give an example of Bangladesh. Before, there is a huge barrier for Braille production because we don't have any common standard. Now we have converted all the books in digital Braille, so anyone can print books from anywhere in the country. They don't need to invest more money. It is 70% cost reduced because now they need only Braille printer and papers. No need to do any editing or typing and so on. So, and there is another challenge, that is the Unicode text. Now we have the Unicode text, so it is easy to convert Braille and easy to convert in multimedia, so on. So, I told you, electronic documents can play a vital role for the creating accessible materials. So as we are now using the computer technology, it is very important to have an accessible electronic document. For the developing world and developing country, our another challenge is the Unicode text. You know, we are using non-standard text. So now we require a Unicode text for our textbooks. Maximum publishers don't like the Unicode text. They are saying that Unicode text is not beautiful. So we don't really like that. So now we need to develop a beautiful Unicode text, which looks nice, and same time can make the accessible for the reading materials. Recent development, yes, Kawamura-san is here, so I'm really afraid to say something. This is the EPOP3, you know that DESI Consortium have been working with that. To convince the publishers. Already International Publishers Association also working on that, the EPUB3. So this is a next generation standard for the publishing house. So if they make this standard, if publishers adopt this EPUB3, so without any extra cost, we can produce accessible reading materials. Also, we can use the different EPUB player to playback our books. And it is easy to print the Brailles and other alternative format. Daisy is my love, you know. I love Daisy because of Daisy. Daisy is an international standard, and they play a vital role to having accessible reading materials for the persons with print disabilities. This is very biggest challenge because, you know, the maximum websites and contents are not accessible. They are not adopting the W3C 2.0 standard. That's why many schools are not able to use the web materials for children with disabilities. I think all nations should adopt the web accessibility standard, and UNICEF can adopt this standard, the W3C 2.0, as a web standard, then all web materials should be accessible for all. You know that another challenge is the whenever we are going for the video film or other audio documents, we are not considering the different needs of the children with disabilities and people with disabilities. Such as I can give you example, just life example I am giving. There was two speech we have listened on Arabic language. There was a text transcription, but there is no audio description. That's why I didn't understand what these two guests give their speech. As a blind person, it was difficult for me to see the text. That's why we saw that all the video documents are sometimes very much challenging for the visually impaired peoples, and sometimes audio documents are really challenging for the hearing impaired if there is no enough audio description or text description for the video and image description, etc. We need to consider the softwares and hardware for the ensuring inclusive education. This is very much needed one. You know, there is many open source technology already developed, such as e-speak, text-to-speech, which is very popular in the South Asia region, and it is free and open source. We are, DOISE Consortium, also providing all the free and open source technology, such as production tools, playback tools, whatever available, which is free and open source. And there is... I think I am almost finishing, so I am not reading this software requirement. I only finish. This is one successful case study. For the first time in the history of Bangladesh, Prime Minister has handed over accessible books to the student with disabilities in 2015, along with other children with disabilities. So this is the really the dream came true. I hope GAATES, UNICEF, and all together we will make a world barrier-free where every children will read without any barrier. Thank you.
Thank you, Vaskar. Our last speaker is Deepak from Nepal. Deepak.
Hello. hello, everybody. I'm from Nepal. My presentation will be slightly different from my colleagues, as they, our country, I mean, we suffer from the recent earthquake, so my presentations will be just based on the current situations after the earthquake, the people with disability facing after the earthquake. So, our country which is known for its natural beauty and traditional architectures, became a derbies and turned into the zero by devastating the earthquake, 7.8 magnitude earthquake, and series of other equally dangerous aftershocks took over the 8,600 lives and injured more than 60,800 people and destroy and damage over the 760,000 homes, directly impacting the 3.8 million people, as well many schools and government buildings, which is the largest humanitarian disaster in Nepal's recent history. This is the very sad news for the country, which was slowly recovering and progressing in the right direction after ending the 12 years bloody civil war with the Maoist regime. This is a devastating incident pushed back the country economy, which may took another decade to recover completely. But imagine not being able to run because you are on a wheelchair after the earthquake, being buried under the derbies, or not being able to call for help because you do not have the ability to speak. How devastating was the earthquake for physically challenged people, because we do not know, there is still no data on the number of disabled people, how many number of the disabled people killed or buried by the earthquake. A global survey done by the UNISDR on 126 different countries among the 5,450 peoples suggests that the people with disability lose and injured in the earthquake, the disaster situation, because they are not involved in the involved in their planning and really concerted about their needs. And this seems valid in the case of Nepal as well. As the whole government and international attention focus on the relief and rescue effort, there is a very little we heard about the special effort by the government, INGO, NGOs, and DPOs focus for the person with a disability. So this presentation will be just focused on the the experience of CIL Kathmandu, in which I am being involved, the focusing on how we did it, what are the challenges we face after the earthquake, how we are managing it, who help us in our effort, and what are our future challenges, and what will be the role in rebuilding Nepal so that it could be more accessible and inclusive society. And finally, how can the leading organizations like the GAATES can play the supporting role through it Nepal Rebuilding Funds. It is true that until the 5 days, there was not any idea what need to do and how to do. There was a lack of information and reliable data about the actual situation of person with disability after the earthquake. The only way we did was contacting the friend through the phone and social media about their situation. Besides our soul call, we are not aware about the situation of person with disability who are out of our circles. But the real and practical effective idea come through from our Japanese friends based in Osaka, to whom we had a very good relationships and who had a very practical experience during the earthquake, Kobe earthquake, in handling the issue of person with disability. Then we started the rescue camp with a 3-tent for 7 people with disability whose house or rental house was damaged by the earthquake. As the masses spread through the social media about our rescue effort, the number of persons with disability increased by 59, and now we have 60 people with disability in more than 8-10. So it was not prepared, and we are not the expert in handling the situation of like this. But the as we started the rescue and relief efforts by our organization, there are the so many issues we faced: the toilet and bathing problems, the safe drinking water, the bedding system for the different kind of the person with a disability, and other hygienic issue related to the women's monthly menstruations and the daily foods for the person with disability who are living in the camp. And there are so many, we got a lot of supports from the community as well as different business organizations and as well as international organizations in our efforts. And luckily, we are being able to continue this effort till the date. But the change situations, the situation after arrival of Japanese paint. After the arrival of the Japanese paint, we felt more ease and tackle the problem. They did not come with the practical ideas, but also come with some of the very essential relief materials like high-energy biscuits, medicine related to the spinal cord injury, diaper, bathing tissue, emergency lamp, and so on. And after analyzing the situation and having meeting with the government agency, they turned back to Japan and has already started the fundraising activity to support our relief and rescue efforts. But we as organizations have also a very doubt the future uncertainty, like how the small organization like ours this big number, how does in small organization ours can manage this big number in a long term? What will happen to the people who are taking care when the issue of the earthquake vanishes slowly from their minds? And what will happen to those people who are in hospital, lost their family, homes being treated at hospital? How we transfer the knowledge and experience to prepare more comprehensive approach to deal the natural disasters like this? And how can we manage the camp in our upcoming heavy monsoon season, which is just knocking on our doors? These are some of the overviews after the earthquake that became the possible by the hard work and kindness, solidarity, and commitment from the people of our network in this movement of having the strong desire of commitment of change to make the society for which we are dreaming and working for. But as the as the global and leading organizations, how the GAATES can play the effective role in rebuilding process, especially in accessibility, and how our good partnership with the UNICEF could help to make the more accessible schools with damage in the huge number by the earthquake. There are different ways and approaches that we can make the difference, but it depends upon the commitment and the continuity. I would like to thank the GAATES Board for creating the special fund for the accessibility in rebuilding Nepal. And my special thanks goes to the current president, Mukhtar Al-Sibani, and the GAATES founder, past president, P.T. Dayan, for playing their strong leadership and bold decision standing behind the people of Nepal, especially to support for the person with disability in this difficult time. So, after the disaster, after this earthquake, GAATES is talking about how they can be effectively involved in the reconstructing Nepal in more inclusive way by promoting the accessibility. We have set some of the objectives during our stay here in the New York, as the government is planning to change the buildings law. How can we establish the accessibility guidelines as the main component of the buildings code? And we are also set on objectives to train the architects and to educate the professional organizations like the architects and engineers, engineering associations, about the importance of the universal designs. And we are also trying to establish the accessibility after the earthquake, there is a lot of attention from national as well as international agency. And in this stage, we are trying to establish the accessibility as a human right issues. And we are also trying to, establish the strong advocacy group for the sustainable movement for the accessibility. So how we are going to achieve it? So the GAATES will try to find, as a country representative from the Nepal, the GAATES will try to find our effort to government and university program to produce the trained architect and engineer on accessibility issue. And we are also trying to conduct the training and sensitization and motivation program to the current practicing professional through their professional network by empowering and improving the media mobilization's capacity to create the pressure for making the accessible new constructions. And we are thinking to collaborate the GAATES efforts with the international reputed organization like the CBM and SOS Children's Village. So we are also, planning to create the more accessible, those more easy version of the accessibility to promote the more accessible environment, accessible environment after this earthquake. So, after the earthquake, now people are being more conscious in structural safety of the building, but they are likely to undermine the importance of the accessibility. Now we have to teach how the good accessibility features are equally important and can help the life-saving tools even in the emergency stage. So in order to achieve all this, the achievement, people with disability of Nepal cannot do it alone. We need more helping hands with the knowledge and expertise. As being the one of the leading organization in the field of the accessibility, I think the GAATES can help a lot in the rebuilding Nepal's in more accessible way. As a country representative from the GAATES, I feel really proud and happy and commit myself to work with full capacity that I have for the change and the equality in creating the inclusive and accessible society where every member of the society could live the life with dignity regardless of the age and ability. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Deepak, for that very informative final presentation. Any comments or questions that people have? Nothing. Okay. Mukhtar, did you want to say a few words and invite people to the reception?
Yeah, I would like to thank our speakers and I would like to thank you all for coming for our GAATES forum for today. I'm happy to invite you all to our reception at the Vienna Cafe. It's open, we should go now. And after this long session, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.